sun refused to shine, yeah. People tell me there ain't no use in trying, yeah.
They did what was right for themselves, arrangement-wise. I mean, it felt like a working-class guy was singing this, a guy whose father or he worked in the coal mines. I mean, it really was a working-class song, and that's what the arrangement felt like. My demo has a whole other kind of feel to it.
Listen to this.
It gets so jazzy.
Yeah, listen.
Pretty wild.
Watch my daddy live and die, yeah. Just
it's a whole other feeling. Very easy. You can hear the writer's bumps.
Yeah.
I mean, it's amazing. Mickey Most, who produced the record, really could hear how it should be done for the animals.
Watch my daddy.
Oh, come on. I gotta turn that off. It's too terrible.
The Animals had talent. They were a great band. I actually thought they were a better band than the Beatles and the Rolling Stones.
So far, no British band had rivaled the Beatles' supremacy in America, but the Rolling Stones were gaining momentum by projecting a much raunchier image.
You knew that with the Beatles, there was arousal, but no possibility of penetration. But the Rolling Stones related much more to this primal sexual awareness, to the point where they made an art form, a cottage industry, out of the notion, hide your wives and lock up your daughters. The Rolling Stones are coming to town.
Like the Beatles, the Rolling Stones had a great affection for rock and roll, but their real passion was the urban sound of Chicago blues.
They more closely resemble the root American promulgators of this music than anybody else, and still do. And of course, it has so much to do with Keith Richards as well as Mick, because he drives the music.
First thing you get waylaid with being like a white kid from England is, what the hell are you doing playing the blues? But the fact is that you need hard times for the best music to come out. You know, maybe that's why the English invasion, because we all lived on rations and things weren't so pretty when we were growing up. You know what I mean? So in a way, you know, we had our blues, like courtesy of Adolf, you know.
The Stones were well aware that if they wanted to match the Beatles' impact on the world of pop, they'd have to write their own songs.
You just sit down, you know, a couple of drinks, a couple of fags, you know, say, oh, that's nice. And then suddenly Mick will walk in, and they start singing over the top, and suddenly it starts to come together.
The writing of Satisfaction started with a Keith Richards guitar riff.
It was a blues dream. I just woke up in the middle of the night, and without even knowing it, I pushed play on my little early cassette player, played it, went back to sleep. I woke up, and there is 30 seconds of satisfaction, you know, in a very slow version, you know, soulful blues version. I can't get no satisfaction. I can't get me no satisfaction, babe, 'cause I try, and I try, yeah, I try, yeah, I try.
Jagger and Richards' English take on the blues sound helped them rival Lennon and McCartney as songwriters. But the Beatles themselves were more influenced by Tamla Motown, the Detroit-based record company already well established by the time of the British invasion. With artists like the Marvelettes, Little Stevie Wonder, and the Miracles, Motown was the first record company to take black music to a global audience. And this success frustrated rival record labels.
Motown were running away with the charts, and we did nothing with our Wilson Pickett's and our Solomon Burkes. Otis Redding made a little dent, but nothing compared to Motown, because there was something built in into the Motown sensibility that went directly to the white heart.
Everybody was listening to Motown music, and that's because I think it was a universal thing, and it was something that people felt good about, and it was artistic too, and it also had the simplicity of the blues, but the complexities of jazz, and the trueness of the country or the folk or whatever it was, and so we never put labels on it. It was just called Motown music, you know.
A key element in the success of Motown was the three-man songwriting team, brothers Brian and Eddie Holland and Lamont Dozier. Starting with Heatwave in 1963, Holland Dozier Holland wrote no fewer than 59 million selling records, easily outrivaling any of the other 60s songwriters.
A good 250 days out of the year, we were jamming in the studio. We were in there piling away, and we, no vacations really. Our job was to turn out hits. We were like Santa Claus and his little elves, you know, turning out the toys for Christmas. We would get kind of heavy with it, and why a girl would like to hear certain words, and why certain things were appealing to the ear of the masses more so than something else, and hitting that target every time where you at least get a million people to rush out to the store. You know what I mean? And it has to do with a lot of, you know, reaching a certain vulnerable spot in each listener. And you have to hit them wherever that, I like to call it a sweet spot. Because the minute you hit them with that little taste of sweetness there, and they just can't bear it, you know, they can't just have one bite, they had to go buy it so they can play it all the time.
Was so prolific that they still had material piling up, waiting for the right opportunity.
We had cut the track, And it had been sitting there for 3 or 4 months, and we hadn't assigned it to anybody or even thinking about the song. Until one time we were reviewing the empty tracks that we had, and this thing, "Baby, I need your love," just came out of me. And then we finished it off, and the top said, "But hey, man, when are you guys gonna, you know, really give us a shot at this thing? We've been sitting around here a year, blah, 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 blah. Okay, hey, what about, yeah, okay. Go to the studio and, baby, I need," their first option. All of them were fun to work with, but the Tops were like really fun. I mean, 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, eating barbecue ribs and drinking cold duck. And, you know, at barbecue all over the microphones. And we're eating and saying, it was just a party. And that's the way we had fun. It was more of a party than a job. But it was always business, though, because the bottom line was that at the end of the day, we had to come up with a hit. We definitely listened to the Beatles. We definitely listened to Brian Wilson. But it was so great, and I loved it because it kept us on us, you know, it gets you riled up. It got the three of us so keyed up and so happy about it when you see somebody else creating, that you're not the only one doing it. It's somebody else really, you know, on your tail.
The surf sound of Brian Wilson and the Beach Boys had made them a household name in America well before the Beatles arrived. They'd scored several big hits over the previous 2 years.
A bushy, bushy blonde hair, serving USA.
The great thing about the 1960s is you had all these different voices all converging, and some of them influencing one another. Brian Wilson having some sort of almost like unspoken competition with Paul McCartney, you know?
We're jealous of the Beatles because they were getting so much recognition. So Mike and I went out and had dinner one night after we heard the Beatles, heard all about the Beatles and heard some of their records. And we said, let's go, let's hit the road, let's start making some good records, you know? I couldn't write on the road. I couldn't get myself to write songs on the road. I needed to be home to write. And I told the guys, we had a meeting one afternoon, and I told the guys, I said, look, I'm quitting the touring group in favor of writing some good songs for you guys. I felt at home in a studio. It's like the most more at home there than anywhere in the world. Well, the group didn't mind. I explained to them, I just want to try something kind of left field, a little bit different. And they go, cool, cool, go ahead. Yeah.
Right now we're going to do a very pretty song that Carl Wilson sings very beautifully.
God Only Knows was one of the standout tracks on Pet Sounds, the album that's widely seen as Brian Wilson's greatest achievement.
Paul McCartney told the press that he thought that was one of the prettiest songs ever written.
I may not always love you, but long as there are stars above you, you'll never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be without you.
Pet Sounds, first of all, is one of the best mixed records, besides how, you know, great the songs were on it and the way that they were sequenced. Everything about it, it's one of the